Hi there, and welcome to this gospel message. It's kind of an unusual one today in that I am going to invite my other partner here on YouTube. I'm John Tyler, the guy that delivers the gospel messages, but then there's also old cowboy John, or Mini-Me, if you will. So I'm going to invite Mini-Me over here, and he's going to ask me some questions, and then I'm going to start it out by asking him a question that I seem to get about him all the time. And again, he will just appear here in just a moment. But the question I am asked the most is that they see the tattoos on his arms, and they wonder, well, what do those tattoos represent? Why did he get them? So we'll let him answer that. And John, come on in. Well, John, may I call you John? Thanks for inviting me. And first of all, I never knew you were this big. It's funny that people would ask about my tattoos. Well, I'll show you, but on my left arm, there is a picture of a Bible, and I'll make sure that we can blow that up and put it on the monitor. But it's a Bible wrapped with a chain and an anchor. And how that came about is the fact that the Word, the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That's in John chapter 1, verse 1. And over in verse 14 of the same chapter, it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That would be when the baby Jesus was born in Bethlehem.
Right.
So
right.
The Word, which is known as the Bible, the Word, was always, it's unbelievable to figure out what always means, that God was always here. Man, that baffles my mind. That's a question I would have, but there's no answer to it. When was the beginning? There was none. But in any event, so that's that tattoo. On the right hand is a chain wrapped around my arm, and hanging off the chain is a cross, and because to me, and to you, I guess, the beginning is the cross. That's where it all begins. That's when you learn to accept the Lord as your Savior. Then the chain wraps all the way around, sort of like a ring, like a wedding ring would be.
Right.
It means there is no beginning, there is no end. But in my case, the beginning starts with the cross hanging off the chain, and it ends up after you're dead. You end up in eternity because of the cross. So that's why I got the two tattoos, and I got them last year in 2011, believe it or not, first tattoos I've ever had in my life. And my kids both said, two of my tough boys, they said, Dad, don't go in and get a tattoo because it's nothing but the house of pain. Well, I had to get the tattoos because I couldn't wimp out on my kids. But the fact of the matter is, wasn't any pain involved at all. That's why I went back and got the second one. So that's why I have the tattoos. But now the people that I come into contact with have questions like this. They're all Bible-oriented, and you're the Bible answer man, supposedly. So let's see what you know. Here's the first question they ask me is, where is heaven? The reason they ask that is they always point up.
Right.
Where is heaven? It's up there. Well, where is there, John? Where is heaven? And I'm going to appear and disappear from time to time here. So, I'll be back and forth to ask you some questions. Well, Mini John, Mini Me, where is heaven? That's a good question, and it's an easy answer. And I get most of these answers out of the book I have written anyway, called Heaven, How Do I Get There? But there are three levels of heaven. One is the air in which we breathe right here on the earth. And these are all Bible answers, by the way, from the Word of God. I don't make this stuff up. I've done my research. But I'm just telling you so I can shorten it and I don't have to refer you to the Bible. Verses I will, if you ask me, just email me, john@johntyler.com, and I'll be happy to do that. But the first level of heaven is the atmosphere right here. The second level is spoken of in the book of Job and elsewhere, where the planets are, the solar system, if you will. The sun, the stars, all of that, the Milky Way, Orion spoken of, the Pleiades, which are constellations spoken of way back in the book of Job. And the third heaven is what Mini-Me is talking about here. And when people ask the question, where is heaven? That's it. That's above this atmosphere, above the next the solar system, and in the third heaven is where God himself resides, as well as the angels and so forth and so on. So, that's the first question. Now, Mini-Me is going to come back and ask me some more questions, and I'm going to be happy to answer those. Be right back. Hi, and welcome back to the next session of these Bible questions being asked and then answered, of course, by myself. But I'm going to invite my little friend, John, the country singer, that you all know from YouTube, my alter ego, back here for just a few minutes. And what he's going to do, from what I understand, having spoken with him recently, is he's going to drop off a list of questions. And then I'm going to ask him to answer just one question I have about his glasses that he wears. Why the sunglasses? There must be a reason. Don't know if it's the glare or what, but he'll be here in just a moment to answer that question, and then he's going to leave and go back to the recording studio and get ready to record some songs for next week. And I know August is Elvis month, so he's talking about singing some extra Elvis songs. So we will see what Johnny Boy has in mind.
Why I wear these sunglasses when I do a lot of the songs?
Well, I'll tell you, in the glare of the lighting that's in the studios that I use from time to time, or inside my $500,000 tour bus that some of them have not seen, you know, the lighting is so strong that you kind of need to. I mean, my little blue eyes are kind of light sensitive. So that's why I wear the sunglasses a lot of the time. Sometimes I won't wear them in certain songs. And other times I'll put on my Elvis glasses. It depends on what part or what role or what song I'm trying to do. Hope that helps. Thanks for inviting me over to your little studio here. Of course, sitting on your little desk here is cute. I feel like sucking my thumb and twirling my hair. But thanks for inviting me. I'm glad I could ask some of the questions that my friends out there in YouTube land have asked me, and I'm glad that you have answered them. And that's it. I'll see you later. I'm out of here. Poof. Gone in a puff of... Welcome back. It's amazing what we can do with cameras and equipment and special effects and all kinds of stuff like this, for example. I don't think you could probably do that. I mean, it's pretty cool. Or just that. And some of the stuff that I'm going to be bringing up out of the Bible is rather shocking, let's say. But some of the things that we do aren't so shocking. So let's get right down to it. John has dropped off some questions to me, but the pieces of paper that he left me were only about this big, so I had to get them blown up so I could at least read the things. But his next question, he was talking about heaven. He says, what is there? And you don't have to go there, but I've been there for you, so that's why I can hurry along here. What is there? Revelation, the book of Revelation, which is where John the Apostle went to, whether in body or in the spirit, he didn't know. But what he saw was sort of the approach to heaven, which was these white jasper walls. So picture white walls, 280 feet tall, that are whiter than any kind of white t-shirt you could possibly bleach. So that's what he saw, and he saw three gates on each wall made out of pure pearl, huge gates. And they were never closed because it's heaven. It's open to whomever God allows in there, and who he allows in there, we're going to come to that in the next question of how do I get there. Well, we've already covered that, actually, so how you get there is just remember, don't forget, click on that link below, and that'll show you how you can get in to one of the 12 gates. It's funny that God uses 12. For example, there are 12 foundations below this 280-foot tall wall. And the foundations are one for each apostle, believe it or not. So 12 foundations, 12 apostles, I get it. And they're made of the same stone that was on the breastplate of somebody way back in the Old Testament. So it's amazing when you study things out, the correlation between the Old Testament and the New Testament. It's just amazing to me. But the colors coming through those walls, some of them are opaque, so you can barely see through. Some of them are translucent, like the emerald ones. So picture a light show flashing up that white wall from the 12 foundations. Unbelievable. And then, as I pointed out before in some of my videos here, I can picture stepping through the front gate, let's say any gate, doesn't matter, but let's say a front center gate, and having this roadway that's translucent gold for streets that you can see right down through the gold, yet you're walking on top of it. And there is a river on either side of this thoroughfare leading to the main city, which is called New Jerusalem. And all of that will be set down on the earth, but that's 1,000 years after the Lord comes back and sets his foot on Mount Zion. That's another whole story. So that's a few of the things that are there. God is there sitting on his throne. And it's a massive throne, and there is fire around the throne, and he emanates all the light that is in heaven. There is no need of light because God's glory itself shines throughout heaven. And then the Bible tells us that the eye has not seen, the ear has not heard, nor can your mind imagine all that's in heaven. So I can only give you a little bit of what John tells me about in the book of Revelation. And that the fruit trees on either side of the street, between the street and those rivers, and they change fruit every month. So again, I pointed out before, but there is time in heaven, even though you're going to be there for eternity, should you be fortunate enough to make the decision to follow what's on the link, which is the salvation link, so that you can get into heaven yourself. Another question that John dropped off, see, here's the papers I blew up, is a curious one. People have asked him, well, you know, will we still be married there? And the it's a good question, because what do you do? Some people love their marriages, they worked out just beautifully, and they'd like to be married forever. Some have just gotten married, and when they get into heaven, it'll be just like maybe they were just married for 2 months. Well, they're ecstatic, obviously. So they want to know, will we be married? Then there are other people that say, no, 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 I don't want to be married to that one. Him or her, whatever the situation is. No, no, no. I'd rather go, they almost say. So the... quick answer to that is no, there is no marriage in heaven according to the Bible. Nobody up there is married. It says we will be known and we will know one another, but we will not we will be as the angels, it says, and not married. Again, we will know one another. We will love each other with the love that God has for us, which is incredible. Again, we can't fathom what kind of love that is. There's no need in heaven to procreate, because you can't procreate. You just, there's no point. When you're in eternity, it's done. You're done as far as rearing children. So all of that stuff is gone by the wayside, but again, we will know and be known. And other people want to know because of the fact that, you know, they were married to Sally over here, got a divorce. 10 years later, they married Mary Ann, and 5 years after that, they got divorced and married, you know, Susie Q, whatever. So, you know, what happens in a situation like that? Plain answer, the Bible says there is no marriage in heaven. Another question, who is Satan? Well, Satan is, most of you know, well, Satan is the devil. The devil, well, what is that all about? And the next question kind of fits in. Where did he come from? God made the angels. And the angel in charge of all the music in heaven was called Lucifer. And he was really, I guess, handsome, or whatever angels are supposed to be, but the Bible says he was handsome. Obviously, very intelligent, but not intelligent enough to figure out that God is God and he was just an angel. So he got jealous when God made Adam and Eve and had these human beings worship him. And he basically said, well, you know, I want some of that. So he banded together with one third of the angels in heaven and tried to overthrow God, stupid individual that he is. And God threw Satan and his band of merry angels, rebellious angels, out of heaven. That comes to this thing called free will, because God gave even Satan and his angels, whom he created, free will to choose to serve him or not, just like he gives you and I free will. So God tossed Satan out of heaven. Where did he land? Most of you would say, well, probably landed in my backyard. And you could be right if you live in Turkey, because I pointed this out before too in one of my videos, that the Bible says in Revelation twice, it refers to where Satan's throne is. It was Pergamos, Turkey, which is now called Bergama. So if you look up Bergama, Turkey, or if you just think about Turkey, it's over next to Iran. It's right in the middle of the Middle East, right in the middle of turmoil. So you wonder why, if Satan landed there. Now, his angels didn't go with him, by the way. They are chained in that second level of three levels of hell, which I pointed out, I think it was in last week's message. There's Hades here, where the spirits go when they die and they're waiting for judgment. Below that is the second level. That's where those angels are chained until they become judged. And the third level, nobody's in it yet, is the lake of fire. That's where everybody goes after the great white throne judgment spoken of in the Bible. Okay, so he ended up in Turkey, which figures. Another question is, and it's a very good one, and it came up a long time ago when I studied and wrote that book, Heaven, How Do I Get There? This is in there along with a map, which I will put up on the monitor. Might as well put it up now. But the question is, where was the Garden of Eden on the earth? It was here. Adam and Eve were set inside the Garden of Eden, and then the Garden of Eden was abandoned and taken away. Well, in Genesis chapter 2, you could find the same information I did. It's a place on the earth where four rivers come together, the heads of four rivers. Well, that's not too difficult to figure out. If you check with me on the monitor, on the map, I'll name the rivers. One was the Pison, Pison River. That no longer exists, by the way. That used to land up into where all the gold was. Much gold, the Bible says. And then Noah's flood came, of course, and everything changed because the earth was flooded. But three of those four rivers still remain. So if you connect all three rivers, you don't need the fourth one, because where they intersect, the three rivers called the Nile River, the Tigris River, and the Euphrates River, you will find a circle, like I've got in the map there, where the Garden of Eden actually was. And it was just below Babylon. Well, Babylon doesn't mean anything to me, John, so you can Babylon all you want, but that doesn't tell me anything. Well, if you get any sort of news these days, you've heard of Baghdad, Iraq. Baghdad, Iraq is now what used to be Babylon. So right there in that little white circle I've got on my map is where the Garden of Eden was. So I thought that was kind of interesting, but you know, the Bible is just full of answers. If you get in there, you'd get to discover them yourself. But I'm just here today to try to help you out to understand some of these questions that people have asked my alter ego and myself. Temptation. Where does temptation come from? Temptation comes from Satan, really, because the Bible says God does not tempt any man. God will test men or women. God will test, meaning send you a trial, but he does not tempt anyone to get into sin. What is sin? Sin is committing evil. Not looking at evil because you're seeing that and you are exposed to it every day of your life. Satan sends it. But Satan also, remember a week ago, you can refer back to it, but where I talked about the body, the soul, and the spirit, and what those three entities are and what their functions are within this house we have called the body. Well, Satan can get to your mind or your soul, the entity within yourself that makes decisions. And he can implant all kinds of evil thoughts, whether through magazines, television, the computer, whatever it is. He'll tell you and try to convince you, go do this evil. So seeing it is not the problem. Dwelling on it and entertaining the devil, that is where you begin to commit the evil, like Eve did in Genesis 3 and verse 4, where the devil said to her, you're going to believe me or you're going to believe what God told you about? If you eat of that tree of life, you're going to die. I say you're not going to die. You're going to believe me? You're going to believe him. She never should have entertained Satan at all, but she did, and therein was her demise. So how to avoid the temptation in the first place, and it's tough, but your spirit within you can tell your soul within you, that is your conscience, your decision maker, the soul, your spirit that comes from God and is influenced by the Holy Spirit that he also sent to dwell within you, can sort of, if you will, gang up on the soul and just say, no. And I've done it myself hundreds of times. You just say, I'm not going there, no. And you overrule your own soul. I know it sounds weird, but you can do it. So that's where temptation comes from, Satan himself. And your spirit within you can overrule your soul within you, the decision maker, and say, no. Or you can play with that for a while and think about it, and then that's where you're committing the sin, is dwelling on the evil thought long enough to where you're going to think about doing something about it, and then you do it. You know what I'm talking about, so I don't think I have to go there. What are the other names of Satan was another question. Well, he has a lot of them, 20 or 30 of them. You have Satan, you have Lucifer, you have Angel of Light, which I'll discuss when we get down into that so-called afterlife experience that some people have had. Beelzebub is another one. Belial, son of perdition, which means destruction. There's a whole host of names that Satan has. Oh, the biggest one that you ought to maintain is this: Father of Lies. If it's a lie, He originated it for you. He even believes that he's not done with God, that he can still, because of the millions and millions, if not billions so far, of spirits that never made it into heaven, that are still waiting in Hades for judgment, those belong to Satan. He thinks he's got a huge army now that can still outnumber all the saints that are going to end up in heaven, that are still there since Jesus died on the cross. Everybody who dies that accepted him as Lord and Savior are already there. It says absent from the body, present with the Lord. So they're there already. But Satan thinks, because he's the father of lies and the truth is not in him, that he can actually overthrow God in the 1,000 years after Jesus comes back, reigns on the earth for 1,000 years with the saints. That's another story. I'm not going down that trail. But that should answer what are some of the other names of Satan. Here we go. Near-death experience. Is that a fact or is that a hoax? You've heard, and some books have been written about it, I died, I was on the operating table, I came up out of my body, I had an out-of-body experience, I went through this long black tunnel, and then I saw this light at the end, and it was very peaceful, and I wasn't really afraid, and the whatever that angel of light is at the end of the tunnel kept telling me, go back, tell everybody it's okay, you don't have to worry about the cross or Jesus or salvation. It's really peaceful back there, but I'm sending you back now. Go write your book. Go make your movie. Just tell them, don't worry about a thing. It's so peaceful on the other side of this black tunnel. Remember, one of the names of Satan, see, this is why studying the Bible helps you, is the angel of light. So you're going down a black tunnel, and at the end of that, you're seeing this bright light, an angel of light who sends you back so that you can write books and report on, don't worry about Jesus, don't worry about salvation, don't worry about a thing. When you die, you're either going into the ground, buddy, or, you know, it's just peaceful back here. You don't have anything to worry about. Who's the father of lies? Right. So, like Eve, you're going to believe Satan or you're going to believe God? That's your choice, you know, free will. Okay, next question is, so anyway, that's a hoax. I'll tell you something that I don't think I've told anybody. When my brother Vern was in the hospital, it was the day before March 2nd, so March 1st, 2011. It was just Vern and me in the hospital room, and he looked up at me and he said, John, I'm in the white tunnel. I'm in the white tunnel. Well, I think I almost know, I just got a chill thinking about that one, but I think it's almost telling me that I know from the Bible it says when you die, you're not going to be ushered into heaven, your spirit, all alone, so you're all afraid. No, no. At least one, if not two angels will escort you right to heaven, and it doesn't take but that long. But waiting in a white tunnel makes sense to me. It's light, it's bright, and there's no dark tunnel. There's no angel of light waiting at the end, no bright light. So if Vern is correct, and it's the first time I've ever heard it, so I mean, I can't say it is or it isn't, but it makes a lot of sense. If you're in a white tunnel and the angels are waiting to escort you out of there, and it's true because he went into his little, like a coma state, and the next morning or next afternoon at 3 o'clock, he was gone, and I did watch his spirit go rise up and go right out of him, and it was an amazing thing. But I know where he is, so that takes all the pressure off me. I know where he is. He's having a ball. He's up there with my mother. My father's there, and some other people that he knows. Okay, can Satan be everywhere? The reason people ask me that, and ask John that, is that they know God can be everywhere, so they figure, well, Satan must be everywhere too. He can be everywhere on the planet at the same time. How can he plant, you know, notions in my mind and then plant notions in your mind? Well, remember, he's got billions of these evil spirits that they're his soldiers. That's his army now. And they certainly do influence they can possess you if you don't have the Holy Spirit living within you. You're an open door that any one of these evil spirits can possess you. So it's kind of nice to click on that salvation link, find out how you can get the Holy Spirit in you, because where the Holy Spirit occupies you, no other spirit can. So it's kind of a nice thing to know that you can't be possessed. You can be influenced, but you cannot be possessed. So that's kind of nice. So can Satan be everywhere? The question is, the answer is no. He is not omnipresent like God. God can be everywhere. God can be anywhere he wishes to be. But Satan was simply an angel. So when he landed in Turkey, if he wants to get to New York to get to the United Nations building, all he has to do is possess a human being, jump on a plane, and he's in New York. So in that respect, he can be where he wants to, but he is an individual. He's not someone or an entity that can be everywhere at the same time. So there you go on that one. Which religion, John, if any, will get me into heaven? Muslims believe that they're going to heaven if they worship Allah. Mormons believe they're going to heaven for some other reason. Baptists, Catholics, they believe they're going to heaven. Sometimes, I guess, people believe they're getting into heaven by good works. So they have a religion of good works. Well, let me tell you, Hindus, Buddhists, I mean, there's so many religions out there. I once had a message that said that before any religions came to this planet, which would have been when Abraham was, which was the year, 1810 BC to 1943 BC, nobody knows for sure. That's BC, before Christ. So that still means there was 1810 years or 1643 years, I mean 1943 years, of nothing, no religions. Out of Abraham came one of his sons, Isaac. Out of Isaac's son came Jacob. Jacob, God called him, from now on your name is not Jacob, it's Israel. So Israel was born, if you will, through Jacob. The Muslim faith, the Muslims weren't even around until Abraham had his first son before Isaac, because he didn't trust God. So he had his son and Ishmael, and Ishmael was the father, if you will, of all the Arab nations or the Muslim nations in the world today. And Genesis, I think it's 17, God says to Abraham, I will make of thee many great nations. He's talking about the nation of Israel, the nation of Islam, if you will, all that kind of stuff. And so God kept his promise. Now, Abraham messed up by not trusting God, or he would have had Isaac, and there would have been the nation of Israel, and we wouldn't have had some of the other turmoil we have and the friction between Arabs and Jews that go on from the time of Ishmael and Isaac to now, today. It's never going to change either, by the way. That comes up next. But, oh, before I go to the next question, so what religion will get you into heaven? No religion. Your religion won't do it. My religion won't do it. So there you go. It's a personal relationship that you have with God through his son, the Lord Jesus, in whom God said, this is my beloved son, listen to him, hear ye him. God stepped out of the scene when Jesus stepped into the scene 2,000 years ago. If you put it all together, it's pretty plain. So what did Jesus say in John, I think 14:6? He said there's only one way into heaven, one way to the Father, and that's through him. So there you go. He says that's the only way to get to heaven. And there are other verses in the Bible that tell you the same thing. So it's nothing to do with religion. It has to do with your faith in God and to believe what he said. And he said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. Do what he now tells you to do. Okay. Next question, will Jews and Arabs ever enter into a peace agreement? The answer to that is, first no, and then I'm going to say yes, kind of. No, in that back in the Old Testament, it specifically says that there will always be enmity, that means hatred, between the Arabs and the Jews, between the Muslims, if you will, now, and the Jews. There will never be peace until the time of the end days, when the Arab nation will sign a peace treaty, a peace accord with the nation of Israel. I think that's coming soon, and I think it'll happen right after Iran gets a preemptive strike launched upon it by Israel, and it's going to be pretty devastating. And when that happens, then the Arabs are going to say, all right, wait a minute, we've got to buy some time here. Let's sign a peace treaty with, and there may be a global government in place by then, I'm not sure. So when that happens, then they're going to sign a peace treaty with the intent to break it. Israel will do a preemptive strike, I've said this before, but it's time to say it again, on Iran, on the Arab world, if you will. Israel will then kick all the Arabs out of Jerusalem, in particular, off Mount Zion and out of Israel. You're banned, do not come back, goodbye, see you later. Then Israel will build a temple on top of Mount Zion. When you see that temple being built, go buy my book, Heaven, How Do I Get There? Because it's in there. Or come back and watch this video, because you've got about, when you start seeing that temple being built, you've got about 3.5 years before the rapture takes place. That's when Jesus comes back in the air, takes all the saints with him out of the earth, and the Holy Spirit goes too. The only ones left here is everybody who's left on the earth that's not saved, and Satan himself. Imagine the one who influences and suppresses and constrains the devil, that's the Holy Spirit, out of here with all the saints. Imagine, you don't have to imagine, because the Bible says for the last 3.5 years, all hell will break loose upon the earth, and unbelievable plagues and bad things will happen to the earth. But the first test of that is, when you see Israel, and you see it in the news every day, I don't know why people don't get it. Iran and Ahmadinejad, the president of Iran, has one goal. Nobody can stop him. There is no peace accord, there are no sanctions. He must annihilate the nation of Israel. He said it. My job is to kill the Jews and drive them into the sea. That's his ideology. You will never change his mind. I don't care if you're President Obama or if you're President Romney, should that happen. I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're the one global leader that will take place in the near future. You're not going to talk Ahmadinejad out of not doing what he has to do. Why he has to do it is his ideology, his mindset. His religious ideology says to him that he is the one that's going to usher in what they call their Messiah, which is the 12th Imam, or Al-Mahdi, he's called. And before Ahmadinejad can usher Al-Mahdi, the 12th Imam, the Islamic Messiah, into the back end of the planet, destruction must happen on the earth. I didn't say it. It's only in their book, which is the Quran. Yes, I've studied that too. Okay, so let me get back to the fact that they will never see peace. But when you do see that temple being built, you got to figure 3.5 years is all you got left. So now it will be time to make that decision to go find my link, if it's still around, and make that salvation pledge. Or you're going to be left behind, and you don't want to be left behind. Bad stuff will happen. Another question, John and Cowboy John, can astrologers predict the future? You know, you hear Sagittarius and Gemini and all that kind of jazz. Can astrologers predict the future? Absolutely, yes, they can. Why? Because the satanic influences on the planet, it's called familiar spirits, and their spirits can speak with evil spirits that are still down there, down here on the planet in this place called Hades. They're waiting for that great white throne judgment. And they'll be here another 1,000 years, I'm afraid, even after the devastation on the planet takes place. So astrologers or soothsayers or fortune tellers, call them what you want to, and I've discussed this in another video too, but this is Bible answer and question time, so you get it all in one fell swoop. They can predict the future in the sense that Satan can say to an astrologer, this will happen, or fortune teller, call it what you want, psychic, this will happen, and he can go make it happen, especially if it's evil. So yeah, they can tell you, or even good stuff. He can create good, you can become an instant millionaire if Satan wants you to. No problem. You willing to sell your soul to the devil for $1 billion? I certainly wouldn't do it. But anyway, the answer to that is yes, astrologers, and the Bible talks about that, and it says do not go see those who have familiar spirits. Okay, let's go to the next one. Can demons be cast out by man? If you remember, maybe you haven't read the Bible, but back in the day, Jesus used, the first thing he would do, really, would be cast out devils who possessed human beings. Remember 5 minutes ago I said, if you don't have the Holy Spirit living within you, you're an open vessel, and Satan can possess you, certainly can influence you, but he can have one of his evil spirits possess you, and you will go do crazy stuff like that kid in Colorado did. You know, some people say it was mental health. No, when evil things like that happen, you're possessed. Some of the kids play with that Ouija board. When you do that, you're opening up your spirit to say, come on in, and let me tell you, Satan and his evil spirits will do that. If you invite them in, they're coming in. So you have to be very careful. If your kids are playing a Ouija board, I know I sound like some of these preachers you hear, he's mental, don't listen to him. It's not John Tyler speaking, it's the Bible speaking. It just says don't do it. I'll get an email, doesn't say Ouija board in the Bible. Listen, there's so many things in the Bible that caution you, stay away from those with familiar spirits. The gateway stuff. Drugs, another gateway towards possession. Okay, let's get off of that. Can demons be cast out by man? The answer is yes and no. The apostles used to cast out demons too. Paul the apostle, who came after after Jesus went to heaven, and he wrote a bunch of the books in the New Testament, he would cast out demons as well. Can they be done now? You know, you see the movie The Exorcist with a head spinning around like that and so forth. The answer to that is, in my opinion, no. Can you ask that devils be cast out by Jesus? Yes. So that's just my opinion. I can't prove it one way or another. What significance might UFOs play in the future? We see so many movies about unidentified flying objects. Are they real? You know, most people believe they are. I believe this, that Satan can create this UFO influence so that, and I firmly believe this is what the story will be when so many people disappear from the planet Earth in what's called the rapture, then you have to explain how did that happen. And the way that I believe they're going to explain how it happened is strictly UFOs. They came, they took all these people away, and that was it. And you'll fall for it, because the Bible says God will cause a huge delusion to come upon mankind. How else do you explain the disappearance of maybe millions of people all of a sudden? You know, my house will be empty. You're welcome to have it. I'm going to another one. Okay, here we go. When are the last days, John? You talk about UFOs. You know, Jesus gave us a lot of hints to when the last days are going to be. A lot of preachers will tell you, nobody knows the day or the hour. And they're right, because they read that in the Bible. No man knows the day or the hour, but Jesus does say, you will know the season. When will the season be? Jesus explains that in the book of Matthew. He said, clearly as a bell, this generation shall not pass away until all is fulfilled. And all is fulfilled. The last thing that needed to be fulfilled was the gospel goes out into the uttermost parts of the world, to every Gentile nation, whether it's in the jungles of Indonesia or what. Well, that's already happened as of October 2010, when they had a huge religious summit in South Africa. Every nation under the planet, under the sun, was represented there. I think it was 210 nations, and I don't think there's any more than that. So the answer is that's done. So when Jesus said this generation, which generation was he talking about, and how long is the generation? Well, you know what? If people wanted to really go into Matthew chapter 1, verse 17, he clearly answered it. He said there are 14 generations between Abraham and the time of, I think it was the time that Israel was forced into Egypt. 14 more generations between the time of then and King David, and 14 generations between David and the time Jesus appeared on the earth. So that is 14, 14, 14. 42 generations between Abraham and the time of Jesus. So it doesn't take a rocket scientist too long to figure out how long is a generation. The mystery is nobody. I mean, my Jewish friends all say, historians all say that Abraham was born, I think it was 1943 B.C. Some have it as early as 1810 B.C. So there's a gap in there. With the gap, a generation comes out to be between 43 and 46 years, because there's either 1810 years between Abraham and Jesus, or 1943 years between Jesus. If you divide those two numbers by 43 to 46, you'll come out with this number, and it's kind of spooky. He says, this generation, when does this generation start? This generation that he's speaking about, when the end days will come. He gets real specific. He says, when you see the fig tree, which is Jerusalem, when you see the fig tree begin to blossom, okay, the fig tree has begun to blossom. Many scholars think, okay, Jerusalem in Israel became a nation in 1948. So 43 to 46 years from then doesn't work out anyway, and it's never going to. I'll tell you why. Jerusalem was not owned and controlled by Israel until the war, the Six-Day War, if you want to call it that, of June 5th, 1967, the Six-Day War. At that point, they then owned East and West Jerusalem. It became a package. That fig tree known as Jerusalem and Israel began to bloom in 1967. Just doing the math, I come up with that temple should be built between the year 2015 and 2017, because of this generation shall not pass away until all is fulfilled. All is fulfilled, according to Jesus, is when that temple gets built on Mount Zion, then, almost to the day that it gets finished, the Antichrist, if you will, comes into the temple, desecrates it. Then Jesus says, when you see this abomination of desolation occur, look up, for your redemption draws nigh. That means he's coming in the clouds momentarily. So there's your answer. And, you know, in the year 2015 or 2017, if it doesn't happen, you can come back to this video and you can call me up or email me and say, John, you're a moron. And you know, that's okay. No man knows the day or the hour, but Jesus does say you will know the season. And come on, let's face it, this is you and me speaking. You know that the earth is going to hell in a handbasket more rapidly now than ever before. It's all upside down, like the Bible predicted. It's all, whatever is right is really wrong now. Whatever was wrong before is not only right, but legal now. So I don't have to tell you, it's coming to a horrific, a good thing for those that are saved, but a horrific ending. And my guess is that you will see it happen in 2015 or 2017. But the key is when you see Israel do some preemptive strikes on Iran, and then they tell all the Arabs, get out of Israel, get out of Mount Zion, and they start building the temple again. You got 3.5 years, I'm just saying. Okay, next question. What is this thing called? Speaking of the rapture, what is this thing called the rapture, John? Well, that's when Jesus appears in the clouds. I know it sounds like a fairy tale, doesn't it? It really does. So you either have to believe or you don't. And 90% of the people on the planet don't believe. It's their choice. Okay, the rapture, according to the New Testament, is when Jesus returns, not to the earth, but when he returns for his saints, you will see him appear in the clouds, and all the saints are going to disappear, if you will, be caught up in the air to meet him in the air, and off to heaven they go. And then, as I say, right then and there, from that moment on, all hell will break loose upon the earth, to where 1/3 of the earth's population will die of different diseases, boils, you name it. 1/3 of the population of the sea will die. And then 1/3 of the vegetation on the earth will also be expunged, deleted, done, checkmate, it's over. And then man will still shake their fist in God's face and rebel and say, and just blaspheme him. Can you imagine? And then the door gets closed finally after that 3.5 years of devastation. Then it's time for a lot of really bad stuff to happen. If you read Revelation, you'll see it was so bad that the seventh angel, six angels opened up seals and poured out horrendous things onto the earth. And it was so bad that God said to John, don't even write down what you saw from that seventh seal being opened. So I'm glad I won't be here, and I hope you won't too. Next, can we test the spirits to see if they are good or evil? Yes, the Bible says that God's Holy Spirit who dwells within Christians can actually, you can detect, you can sense, you have discernment, and you know when bad vibes are coming your way from some evil. That reminds me, by the way, it's not a question here, but are there ghosts? Yes, those spirits that I tell you that are demonic or that have never made it into heaven, they just rejected what Jesus did on the cross and they said, no, and then they died. It's too late. So their spirits are still here on the earth and they're free to come to and fro from this place called Hades within the earth, and they can possess bodies if they like. They can possess bodies of animals or people or whatever. Or they're free to roam. If somebody, you hear about ghosts being in houses, I got to give you a first-hand experience for me. I had a house, won't tell you where, but I had a house, well, actually two of them. One is one of my sons brought a kid in there that played around with a Ouija board unknown to me, and that place was so possessed, it was pathetic. Nice house, I had to sell it. But I mean, I'm talking about drawers opening, stuff flying off the bureaus. If you ask my kids, they'll tell you this thing that can't possess me because I was born again or saved at age 11. Certainly, I've never said anything like this before either, but I'm going to tell you. I was just in bed one night and this thing like oppressed right on top of me and I couldn't move. You say, John, you were dreaming. No, I wasn't. I could not move, and I was I finally had to invoke the name of Jesus, which is how you can get rid of those evil spirits. Well, you sing a hymn or something, and man, that thing left. But I get rid of that house shortly thereafter. Another house I bought, I always felt creepy going upstairs into the back bedroom that was up at the top, the second floor. And it often felt cold and clammy there. You say, well, John, you're scaring me now. I'm just telling you the truth that, yes, these ghosts or spirits are real. So I often wondered, well, why is that so? And I gutted that house, by the way. I totally renovated the house. And it seemed to have disappeared at that point, especially when I redid the attic and put insulation in there. But I didn't know anything until the next door lady says, oh, well, I guess my brother-in-law didn't tell you, or her brother, who used to live in the house, and the reason he moved was a little bit spooky there. But apparently some girl died in the place of a drug overdose in the back bedroom up on the second floor. Ooh. So that's why I felt creeped out there. That's why I almost felt a cold breath right on me. So the answer to that needs to be, or the question that needs to be answered, and I just did, is yes, from my own firsthand experience, ghosts do exist, and you can test them to see if they're good or evil. That one there was obviously evil because it, spirit, never made it to heaven, so it could certainly influence us. Is the Messiah coming, or did he come already? I don't know how many people, if you're Jewish, you say, no, he didn't come, he's coming, we're waiting. Moses said he's coming. Moses described it, and I said that in last week's message. I gave you the chapter and verse on it, so I won't bother doing that now. But Moses said the Messiah is coming. Daniel the prophet said the Messiah was coming. They gave all, you'd be born in Bethlehem, born of a virgin. I could keep going, but there's probably 50 different things that point. Elijah said he's coming. John the Baptist said he's here. Jesus himself said, here I am. So the answer to that is, yes, the Messiah came. Who was the Messiah? Jesus. Is it because John Tyler says so? No. You have to believe God's word, which I do. You have to believe evidence in front of your face, which I do. You have to believe the eyewitness of 515 people recorded in the Bible by living people, like Luke, the historian of the Bible, and also a physician. No dummy. And on and on and on I could go. And if he were not the Messiah, and if he did not come and die on the cross for your sins and mine, if he was not resurrected, I have to ask you once again, why would the apostles be so stupid as to keep going and preaching the word that points to Jesus, and the apostle Paul, who never met Jesus, by the way, why would these people keep preaching Jesus and the cross and what he did and his resurrection that they saw? Why would they, and die a violent death, which they did, why would they do that? Just for kicks? No. And when you have 500 witnesses, that's a pretty good court case. And 500 people within Jerusalem saw Jesus after he was resurrected. He spent 40 days on the planet talking with his apostles and laying out for them what to write down that we now have as the New Testament, which was the culmination of all the prophecy spoken of in the Old Testament. Okay. John, what are apostles and what are disciples, and is there a difference? I think I've covered this once before, but an apostle means a chosen out individual. Jesus chose his own called out ones, his own apostles. He chose 12, one of which was Judas, who Jesus knew, and David in the Psalms, 25th Psalm, says that one will eat with him and betray him. Well, obviously that happened. So then there would be 11 apostles. Peter at a meeting in the book of Acts stood up and said, wait, we're supposed to have 12 apostles. So mankind, Peter and his guys that were all there, the disciples, which means followers of Christ, not selected or chosen out or called out ones, but disciples, are followers. John the Baptist had his disciples. Bill Gates has his disciples or followers, if you will. Gurus on the earth have their disciples or followers. So there were 11 apostles. Jesus chose out the 12th apostle, which was the Apostle Paul. Those 12 will be sitting at 24 seats. I pointed this out before, because the Bible in Revelation and elsewhere said there will be, and I saw 24 seats around the throne, 12 of them occupied by the 12 tribes of Israel that left the other 12 for the apostles. There's not more than 12 apostles. There's not 120 of them. There are 12. There's 12 foundations that support that wall. One name for each apostle. We could go on forever, but there's only 12 apostles. But there are literally millions of disciples, which simply means followers of the teachings of Christ. Okay. So, is God monotheistic or polytheistic? Is God monotheistic, meaning is he one God? Or is he poly, which means more than one God, theistic? Polygamy means two wives or more. Could be 10 wives. So more than one is what it means. Get it? My Jewish friends say no. God is, and Islam says the same thing, by the way. God is one God. And they're right in the sense that he is one entity. But that same one God that they say, no, there's no Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But the same God that they say is one God says in the book of Genesis, which is the Jewish Bible, I mean, they have the five books of Moses. Genesis was written by Moses. Right in there, God said, let us, plural, make man in our, plural, image. And he says that a couple of different times. And then you go through the Old Testament and you find that God is the Father and the Son was and is Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Who was that? Only one, Jesus. So the God the Father, God the Son, and God throughout the Old Testament says, and my spirit was placed upon Moses or this guy or that prophet or whatever. So the answer to that is he's polytheistic, a trinity, just like in last week's message I said, you are also made in God's image. You are a trinity. You are a body. Jesus was a body. You are a soul, which is a conscience, if you will. So is the Holy Spirit, and he becomes your conscience to help you, lead you, and guide you in the way in which you should go. And then there is the spirit that God has put into you, because God is a spirit, of knowledge and wisdom. And within that spirit that he's placed within this vessel called the body is that spirit that is the one that knows the difference between good and evil, right from wrong, and that is as a result of Adam partaking of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So God puts the knowledge of good and evil within your heart, mind, spirit. Okay, so that should answer polytheistic trinity. If I am good, will I go to heaven? No. No. Ephesians 2:8-9 specifically says that it is by God's grace that you are saved, not of works. So no matter how good you can be, you cannot go to heaven. Otherwise, you've mitigated what Jesus did on the cross. Why would God send his only son to die on a cross for your sins and mine? The only one that can forgive your sins and mine is Jesus, God's Son. Hear ye him, that's my beloved Son, whom I sent to this earth to bail you out, to be the one-time sacrifice for your sins, the blood sacrifice that's required of God. His only Son gave his life for you and for me. So therefore, he's the only one that can save you. No matter how good you are, you cannot get into heaven. Now, the next question is, well, if I'm bad, will I go to hell? No, you could be good and still go to hell. How do I know that? In Matthew, Jesus said to this rich young ruler, he said, Lord, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Pretty good question. So Jesus looked at him and he says, well, you realize that there are 10 commandments. Have you kept them? Oh yeah, I've kept them since my youth. I went to school, I went to synagogue. The rabbis taught me. I know and keep the Ten Commandments. Jesus, having known already, because he is God, he knew that this guy lacked one thing. He put his wealth in front of God, in front of serving him. So he put it this way to the rich young ruler. Well, I'll tell you what, sell all that you have, give it to the poor, and come and follow me. So he told him what he needed to do, and the rich young ruler sadly went away, and Jesus was sad at the fact that he put his riches before Almighty God, before going to heaven, and it was nothing to do with his riches. He just had put something ahead of God, and when you have, he broke the first commandment, thou shalt have no other gods before you, and he broke it, and he knew he broke it. That's why he walked away sad. So that should answer that. Good or bad makes no difference. You have to click on the link, find out what salvation's all about, help yourself or not, and that's where we'll leave that one. What is the book of life, and am I in it? The answer to that is, the book of life is what Jesus will open one day, just when the great white throne judgment is going to be held, and every soul, good or bad, including the devil himself and all those angels chained up in the second level of hell, all appear before God. God looks over at his son, which would be on his right hand, and say, is that name for John Tyler written in the book of life? And Jesus will say, yes, it is. Okay, enter into eternity, which is in heaven. Go to the banquet. Enjoy yourself. Very good. If your name is not found in the book of life, then God tells his angels, cast that one into the lake of fire, and that's the end of it. That's at the end of that time, when it's judgment time, then death and Hades, which means Satan himself, and Hades, all those spirits that are in that place called Hades, but for the moment that they are judged, they're all cast into that third level of hell where nobody is right now. Then that lake of hell will certainly be full of these spirits, including Satan. So the answer to that question is, are you in the book of life? Yes, you are in there until you die. If you read Revelation 3:5, it says, Jesus says, whoever endures to the end, whoever makes it to the end, which means whoever makes it to the point of death, that is the end, and they endured, that means they trusted him as Lord and Savior, then he says, then I will not blot their name out of the book of life. Now you read it, you figure it out, you tell me something different. So that's why babies who die or are aborted by their mothers who don't know any better end up in heaven. Retarded people who cannot make a decision to accept the Lord or not, they don't know the difference sometimes between a fork and a knife. They, and no offense to them, but I'm just telling you the truth, that if they cannot make a decision, they're not condemned into the lake of fire, and they are ushered into heaven as well, by default, if you will, because that's just the way it is. They can't make a decision. Babies can't make a decision. They're ushered into the kingdom of God. It's automatically. Their name is not blotted out of the book of life, per Revelation 3:5. John, what is the unpardonable sin? Well, the next question says, what is the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? Well, let me tie the two together, because some people think that one means the same as the other. It doesn't. The unpardonable sin, that means the sin that God cannot pardon. And most preachers will tell you, God can pardon any sin because he's God. There's one that he cannot pardon. And you know what it is? It's rejection of his son. That is the unpardonable sin. When you have the choice, which you all do, to accept the Lord as your Savior or reject what he did on the Christ, that is the unpardonable sin. That is the sin where God cannot forgive it. And when you're dead, your name gets taken out of the book of life because of that unpardonable, unforgivable sin. You will never inherit eternal life. You will never step one foot into heaven. You will end up in the lake of fire if you reject his son. John, you're mean. You shouldn't say that. Folks, I'm just reporting what the Bible says. This is Bible question and answer time. Okay, blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. Jesus pointed that out because it was at one point where the Pharisees came up to Jesus and says, you know, you're casting out demons and because you have Beelzebub in you, which means you have the devil in you. That's the only way you can do that. And Jesus says, basically, that is you're committing blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. You're saying that the Holy Spirit who dwells within me, Jesus speaking, is that he says two, that this temple cannot occupy two spirits, which is why I said earlier, if you have the Holy Spirit in you, the devil's evil spirits can't possess you. Jesus said the same thing. But the Pharisees were basically saying the spirit that's within you, who is God's Holy Spirit, is the devil. That's blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. I think that's probably pretty clear. If God is so loving, why do people go to hell? Well, if God is so loving, why do people go to hell? That used to drive my brother Vern nuts for years and years and years till finally he figured it out. If God is so loving, why does he send people to hell? Little old grandmother never did anything wrong, just never accepted the Lord as a Savior. Is she going to hell? Yes. Why would God do that? God has never sent anybody to hell, ever, ever. Remember, he gives us the free will. He also gives us the knowledge of God is written on the hearts of all men. Read Titus 2:11, and you'll see that it says, for the knowledge of God is written on the hearts of all men. Do men seek God? They choose not to, or they choose to. If you seek God, and you choose to seek God, forget about Jesus for a minute, but if you believe that there is a God, and 97% of you folks say that you do, then you need to go pursue that. And you need to go ask that God that you believe in, I don't care what your religion is, God, point me to the truth. I assure you on the authority of God's word, he will point you to the truth. And the truth is, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man can inherit heaven or see the Father except they go through me. John 14:6. So if you seek the truth, you will find the truth. So that is why God must punish sin, because he is a just sin. But you don't have to fall under the condemnation, if you will, of the Ten Commandments, because Jesus said, I came to fulfill the law. I came to give people who believe on me and accept me as their Lord and Savior, I came to give them the free gift of eternal life. It's by God's grace that they have eternal life, not by anything they did. Remember Ephesians 2:8 and 9. So the answer is that God must still punish sin. That's why at the great white throne judgment, when he asks you, what did you do with my son? And you say, well, and you can't lie to God because he knows exactly the moment you recognized truth and you rejected it and you didn't want to do anything about it, you're kind of on your own at that point. So don't blame God, blame you. You have a free will choice, just like I did. I made the choice, you can make the choice too. Does God use crippled Christians? A crippled Christian would be like, you're a Christian, you've accepted the Lord as your Savior, you're sitting in church, you're doing everything you should be doing, and then one day you decide, well, you know what, I've had enough of this stuff, I think I'm going to go and do whatever, or that sin sets in, the evil sets in, and you decide you want to commit to do the evil, so you're off and you're doing your little fornication routine, or your adultery routine, whatever it is that's evil. Then you are backslidden, if you will. Let's say you get a divorce, like I did, and let's say a whole bunch of things. You're a crippled or wounded Christian. Wounded in that, I've said this before, I can never become a pastor of a church because the Bible says if you have not ruled your own household well, which means husbands, love your wives, then you can't rule a church. Same with the deacon, by the way. So I can be an evangelist, I can share the word because go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. That's a command of every Christian, whether you're crippled or not. So God does use crippled Christians. And let's go back before Christianity came into being. Let's go all the way back to Psalms and King David. We all know he was a nice guy, shepherd boy, age 17. God calls him to be the king of Israel after Saul, blah, blah, blah. He waits 13 years, becomes the king. He's the big shot king. He's looking down on the roof. There's Bathsheba. She's naked. She's taking a bath. He gets the binoculars out, even though they didn't come out till 1620. He's looking over the precipice there, and he decides, I like what I sees. So he calls her over. They do the fornication routine. He does the adultery because she was married to one of David's soldiers. David sends her husband off to war, tells his first in command, put him in the front lines. The guy gets killed. So anyway, he was wounded. His righteousness was counted to him because he believed God. He sought after God. He was a friend of God. He repented of all that, and God forgave him of that, which is all pre-Christ and pre-the cross stuff. And remember, the nation of Israel, which David was part of, they had to do blood sacrifices, sometimes weekly, sometimes monthly, but certainly annually for the sins of Israel. And that kind of covered it over until the final one-time sacrifice of the cross came. Okay, so yes, God can use crippled Christians. What is my purpose on the planet? I know what mine is right now, but you know it's fluid. So the only way I ever found out what my plan and purpose on the earth was, because remember, if you know my story, I used to do everything myself. I did it on my own, and I was very successful doing it that way. But one day I just wanted to know, Lord, in December of 07, Lord, show me your plan and purpose for my life, because whatever it is, that's what I want to do. I don't care about the rest of this stuff. And he figured out I must not, because he took it all away. He's a God of restoration too. So again, like I said, I think in one of the messages, sent me to boot camp, 16 months of torture, not really, learning experiences, and I wouldn't trade it all for all the money I ever had. Okay, so your purpose, you can find out if you just ask God, what is my plan and purpose, and you mean it, he'll show you. Two questions left and we're done. Thank goodness. Should I go to church? Some people stay out of church. Nah, I don't have to go to church. I'll watch Reverend, what's-his-face there on TV, the Pan a Smile guy, or Charles Stanley, or J. Vernon McGee, or John Hagee, or whomever. I'll just watch the TV preacher, and I don't have to go to church. And you know what? I'd say that I agree with you, except for the Bible says, forsake not. That means do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is. Therefore, the answer is, yes, you should be in church. But John, I haven't found a good church yet. Keep looking, because you're still avoiding what God tells us to do. Why does he tell us to do that? Because we're all one body in him, and we go there to edify one another, to encourage one another, to pray one for another like the scriptures tell us to do. We do there to go take care of God's house, which I'm going to get into that question in the second one from here. And, you know, there's a whole host of things we can do, but we can't do it by ourselves. We must be in a place of worship. Can I worship God at home? Sure, and I do. But there is a thing called corporate worship, which the Bible says, forsake not yourself the assembling of yourself together as the manner of some is. Okay, should I pay tithes? John, should I pay 10% of my income like all those preachers up there, whether on TV or in my church, tell me to do? The answer to that is this. The Old Testament was written to the Jews. Tithing was a mandate of the Jews. The Old Testament was also written, there are some principles there that we as Christians should carry forward with us. Jesus says, I'm not here to mandate anything. Should you give out of necessity, meaning somebody's telling you, you need to give or else? No. No. You give because you want to give. Jesus came and said, I got two commandments for you. Love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, and your mind, and your might, and love your neighbor as yourself. That takes care of the Ten Commandments, no problem. But let me go back to the nation of Israel. The principle was set for tithing because 11 of the tribes that were working were to take care of the Levi tribe, the 12th tribe of the nation of Israel, and their specific and sole job was to run the temple. God said to them through Moses, look, get 10% of the income from the 11 tribes so that you can support my temple. It costs money to run the temple. So based on that principle, I say that you should take the 10% level of your income. That is, what part of my income, John? I got to shorten this because I'm running out of time. What I have discovered is that God gives you a daily bread budget. Say it's $3,000 a month. That's your obligations. And you have to pay your obligations. Your mortgage, your gas, house insurance, blah, blah, blah. But part of that budget, you should incorporate whatever your income is. If it's $5,000 a month and after taxes you got $4,000, but the nut is $3,000, you got $1,000 left over. To me, that's called prosperity that the Bible speaks about. And the New Testament says, as God has prospered you, bring that to the church on the first day of the week, which happens to be Sunday. But if you go to church like Seventh-day Adventists and it's a Saturday or whatever, if you're Jewish, you got to tithe. But if you're not Jewish, the principle of it takes 10% of every individual that's working to support the house of God, whether it be a temple or a church, then I subscribe to that and I do that, but it's not mandated. So I don't have to do it. Do I want to do it? I want to serve what the Lord has set out in principle. And the other beauty that nobody gets out of the New Testament is that you give more than that. You give out of your prosperity. How much prosperity will God give you? You all know by now, Deuteronomy 8:18 says, it is God that gives you and me the power to get wealth. If you're willing to go and support other things like winning souls, soup kitchens, that type of stuff, and God knows that your heart is right, he says if you give bountifully, if you give a lot of your money that I gave you in the first place, I'm going to give it back to you bountifully, good measure. Pressed down, shaken together like a barrel of leaves, overflowing, will men put it into your possession? So the principle of the Old Testament giving a tenth of your income, that is your prosperity, to support the church, yes, I subscribe to that. Is it mandated? No, it's all voluntary. So is giving more than that. My goal, as most of you know, is to give 90% of the prosperity. So I hope that the good Lord arranges that, and then I can finish my book called You Can Take It With You. I'm at 495 pages right now, and all I lack is that one other thing, which I'm still waiting for God to do. Finally, and the last question, thank goodness we're out of here, is this. When I close my eyes, John, the last time I close my eyes on the planet, just like your brother Vern, what will I see a moment later when I wake up in eternity? Will I be in this place called hell? Or will I be awake, opening my eyes? The next thing I'm going to see is this place called heaven. The answer is, if you click on the link below and you find salvation in the Lord and you trust Him as your Lord and Savior, you're going to wake up and see what's in heaven. You'll be in the white tunnel escorted to heaven by angels. If not, you're going to be roaming around in this place called Hades for about 1,000 years after that temple is destroyed and the rapture takes place, and then you're going to, boy, the lights are hot in this studio, I'll tell you that. I'm beginning to sweat. Thank God I'm going to be ending this. So you're either going to wake up in eternity in heaven, absent from the body, is to be present with the Lord, or you'll wake up not in hell, but in this place called Hades, and you'll, that's the torment, right there, right off the bat. You got to wait, knowing that you got to go face God at that great white throne of judgment, and that's not going to be fun at all. So, that will wrap it up, and as I say, it's been good to be with you. My little friend that was here earlier says hello and goodbye. He's over singing some songs so that we can extract you back in so you can hear these messages. That's my job. God's job is to bring folks like you and all your friends in here so they can also hear from the Word of God. I'll see you next week with another message. Whew. See you later.